Hello, everybody. If I can quieten you down, we can get off. Welcome. Welcome to Ravensbourne's Is Documentary Relevant in a World with Information at Your Fingertips? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to introduce the panel. A quick note that it is going to get warm in here, I'm told, fairly quickly. Without further ado, in the city that brought you the full Monty, for one night only, we have an interesting panel for you. And if it does get too warm, it might get even more interesting. So what we're going to do is we're going to go down the panel, we're going to introduce ourselves. I'll very briefly start. I'm Dr. Freddie Gaffney. I run the film course at Ravensbourne, and I'll pass on to my left.
Hi, I'm Marie James. I've just spent 8 years at Channel 4, having recently left to work more independently.
I'm Tom Long. I'm an ex-Ravensbourne student. I left 4 years ago, and I've just finished my first feature doc.
I'm Ulrike Kubatta. I'm an independent filmmaker, documentary filmmaker, working on my second feature right now.
Andy Whittaker, founder of Dogwoof, distributor and international sales, and doing the Michael Moore movie that was last night.
I'm Kate Cundall, and I am the VP of Factual Acquisitions at DRG, who are international distributor.
Lovely, thank you. So perhaps we could welcome our guests. Thank you very much. Now, our central question is documentary relevant in this modern world, in this world where my daughter was looking at penguins live, whichever pole it is, Antarctic, I think, isn't it? Showing my ignorance. But she was looking at them live. She didn't need David Attenborough in the way. So is what we do relevant anymore? So I'd like perhaps to start first with the people who buy and sell films rather than the people who make films. So perhaps I could throw that question towards you. Is there relevance to the controlled and shaped documentary anymore?
Yeah, I mean, we were just talking about this while we were sitting waiting for everyone to come in. And it's not as simple in terms of selling documentaries, in fact, any TV content in the market now, but there's more opportunities almost, but they're just all in different places to where they were maybe 5 years ago. Yeah.
And what's another way? So I think there's a difference between urgency
and
depth. I think that'd be one of the ways I would take it. So obviously, you know, take BuzzFeed, especially with these, you know, these wonderful headlines that, you know, get you to click the clickbait things, and that, you know, it's great and that drives the traffic and the interest, but that, you know, what's underneath that and the depth of, you know, what's the story?
Depth, I think, is an interesting concept. We're constantly told that, you know, people in their, probably under 30, you know, spend their time clicking, and I think the click rate now is about 3 seconds before they lose interest. How do we give them depth?
I think by picking the right subject matter, ultimately, you have to, yeah, have to, but the documentaries, the one-off documentaries that tend to sell well or have a lot of international appeal or demand tend to be noisy in that they've hit the zeitgeist in some way. So, for example, we distribute My Son the Jihadi, which True Vision made, and that has done very, very well internationally because, obviously, it's a very topical subject at the moment, and people all over the world are interested in it, which means, from a sales perspective, you make a lot more money.
Which is an important part of the whole business, of course.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. If I can turn to the makers for a moment, I'll ask that same question. What is the relevance of what you do when I can just kind of make my own documentary by clicking away on a mouse?
I think it's going to sound really cheesy, but it's the ability to inspire. I mean, I don't use social media too much, and it kind of winds me up that everything you see is, it's very surface. And I think as filmmakers, it's an opportunity to actually, you can look at things deeper and you can present your, you know, your story. I mean, every film you ever watch is, it's you and how you want to present it. And trying how to put this.
So, Ulrike, perhaps I could ask you. Mm. You know, you're an established documentary maker, and you will have seen the market changing.
Yeah.
How do you feel that your work is being impacted by the developments?
Well, I certainly have an awareness of how things have changed, and but I'd still like to think that long-form documentaries, or what I make and everybody else makes in that field, these films are highly relevant. I think as a documentary filmmaker, you know, it's already been said about complexity, we mentioned depth, and I think first and foremost it's about storytelling. And storytelling happens over time, and that's how you get the complexity across. I think in terms of being a documentary filmmaker is that, you know, your challenge is to familiarize yourself with what's out there, what reaches people and what reaches different audiences, and then try to adapt that or add that to your filmmaking, you know, and that can happen outside of the actual, you know, feature doc. Mm-hmm. You can, you know, transform certain parts of your documentary into, you know, shorter versions, or, you know, for different platforms, that you can kind of summarize certain themes that you work with within the film and still play with that and find creative ways of expressing these ideas. So I think that's actually really exciting. You know, I'm neither, you know, oh, this is bad and this is good. I think, you know, you can't afford to have that position.
I'm going to bring Marie in on the back of that, if that's right.
So my role in Channel 4 was as an online producer, and some of what, sitting in the commissioning team, so a lot of what we were doing in the end was commissioning sort of, short documentaries. But one of the programs I worked with was Unreported World, which is a half-hour current affairs show that's on the Channel 4 on Fridays. And I was tasked a few, 3 years ago, I think, with bringing that to a younger audience. And it was quite, you know, so, and how would we do that? It's obviously use social media, use Facebook, use YouTube, to sort of test it in those waters. And that meant cutting a half-hour show down into, you know, under 5 minutes, 4 minutes. It was, you know, an interesting experiment that has actually reaped many rewards, because we understand that it's a very different style of storytelling. And the style of storytelling people want is a much more immediate and much more emotive in that moment, in that instance. And visually, there's a difference in style. There's a difference in the shots you'll use. You know, you will package it in a, you know, not in the, you won't open with a long, ambling, wide shot, for instance. You know, it's always better to go in with something that's really close up, because if you've got pre-roll on Facebook, you know, you need to know what you're looking at if you're looking on a mobile phone. You know, those are the things that, you know, in terms of physically, there's a difference. For me, that's one of the ways to look at it. In terms of what it is that you commission, we were surprised, because stories that Unreported World show, you know, weren't seen as being interesting or exciting, but some of the biggest films were, you know, a young child in Africa who learned to, he learned sign language for the first time. You know, the first time he ever spoke, 15 years old, that was viewed 27 million times. I mean, you know, you don't know what you're going to get. That was unexpected, you know, and I think that that's when you realize that there is definitely an interest. It's just how you tell the story and how you reshape it to fit the younger audience and the online mediums.
So Tom, as a new filmmaker, how are you shaping your story for this new world?
So hard. I think.
Or is it a case that you're just making a documentary?
I think, I mean, from everyone I've spoken to my age, and we've kind of very much grown up with social media since starting uni, it's really hard keeping people's attention. And what we're very aware of is where people maybe used to invest 10 minutes to watch a short, even with stuff we're doing now, you've got 30 seconds to grab their attention. So everything we've done from a documentary point of view, it's really difficult, because you want to build up and you want to take them through a progression, but you've got to put your best bits in first to an extent. And there's been a lot of times where we haven't wanted to, and we wanted to lead into things, but you've got to keep people engaged. So it's exactly like, it's like watching a trailer. You'll get people very, very quickly, or you'll lose them very quickly of a trailer. And it's kind of like that, even with the documentary stuff we're doing now. You've got, it's so important to catch them immediately. So the way we do it, I mean, we would normally, we put a lot of our, we'll put the structure of the interview in kind of to start. So as opposed to, yeah, building into it, we'll drop a few of the bombshells in. So you get people's attention straight away.
So is it a case of, you know, kind of like fishing? You keep dangling the flyer, you keep flicking the flyer to keep them with you.
Yes, exactly that.
So with that in mind, I'll hop back down the other end, if I may. With this concept that the audience now has this incredibly short attention span, how do you sell that to companies who perhaps aren't necessarily so conscious of that?
So, actually, can I play a clip? I've got a short clip. It's longer than 10 seconds. I think it's the guy on the panel. So we did a film called Blackfish, which is about killer whales in SeaWorld. And we've got a very, literally a short teaser. So,
is it possible to play a clip?
So that was, and that's 2010, right, which he says at the start. So, of course, what we're talking about here is, you know, stuff being old after an hour.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So I think in some ways you want, I don't know, what's the concept? Is it the truth? I mean, I'm not sure, maybe there's a debate there about this, the myth of the truth or something. But I think in some ways you need some, to actually dig into that story. Because, you can imagine now that Twitter and, reactions and where that goes. But I think the beauty of Blackfish is, so that's that event, and obviously that's it hooks you in straight away. But, why did it happen, and what's the story, what's the character, talked about characters and everything. So I think, a duty of documentary, or, it's that good story, and finding out more about it and building, comes back to that depth, and Blackfish, is a brilliant example of that as a film, and as a documentary that, you can't get across in 10 seconds, why is that? And also looking at the different sides of the story. And I think maybe also after the release of the film, but sort of pick that up maybe later in the panel, but the reactions to when the film showed, and also how people, tweet and the pressure on SeaWorld itself. Mm-hmm. But I think, definitely, but the hook of that, the idea of that teaser is the hook of that, it's very clear.
Mm. Katy?
I think it's about bringing a very specific perspective to things, because people obviously engage in news and current affairs on a daily basis generally. So if you're bringing a unique perspective or a unique view on that, or even a view or a perspective on it, people will engage in that. Obviously you have to, that our job is to create the noise around that and to make that feel really interesting in the 2-3 minutes that you have to grab someone's attention, or less, depending on where you're putting your trailer. And then, like Andy said, you want to watch that film because the trailer is well cut and it makes you go, oh, what's that about?
Ulrike, as a filmmaker, how do you feel about the noise that needs to be created in order to sell your film?
Well, yeah, I have a kind of slightly twisted view on it, I guess. it's necessary, it's essential, done particularly, well, I do get excited about it because it's challenging and you've got to think of ways of, putting a spin on your film so that you can reduce it to a very short one sentence or a 10-second teaser to, get people's interest. But it's still, the challenge is still to, once you have caught your audience, to then get them to sit down. It's all very well to get initial interest, but, you still hope that someone will have, wants to take 90 minutes or more to sit down and witness, an argument of evolving and, I agree, different points of views. The perspective that you give in your documentary, that's something you don't get from 10 seconds or, it's about gathering information, but there's no perspective behind it.
I think that's a great point. Oh, go on, you go.
Yeah, sure. I was thinking that since I'm, you know, being here in Sheffield, there are a lot of young people interested in documentary. Mm. And, you know, I think that there are a lot of young people watching long-form documentary and long-form anything. You know, there is an inquisitiveness and an ability to inquire and explore and investigate that was never at anybody else's fingertips in any other generation before this point. So I think it's, to say it's just a short attention span, I think is quite dismissive, possibly. Mm. Because I think, you know, what maybe people should think a little bit more about is how you tell a story. You know, we're in an age of entertainment. There's a number of different mediums through which people tell different stories in different ways that maybe is a bit more grabby, but some things are more abstract and long. You know, even in the games world, you know, some of the most popular games are pretty abstract. You know, there isn't a hell of a lot visually, it seems, going on. You know, you just have circles and colours sometimes, or lines and movement, you know, and yet they're being played. So I think it's some of it maybe is this changing point where traditional styles of television making are kind of having to compete with a new world of thinking.
And in that new world of thinking, is it a kind of tortoise and hare moment, where we have the long form tortoise that has got depth and gravitas, and then the hare, which is the instant fix of information?
I would say there's definitely a tortoise and hare, but I don't know if it's as distinct as that. Mm. Because, you know, I think it's technology, people, content catching up with technology, storytelling catching up with technology, and vice versa. You know, the traditional and the new kind of working themselves out.
What about new ways of watching this content? How's that beginning to impact on the form? I don't mind who goes for this one.
Mm. Well, I mean, DRG are fundamentally a television distributor, so we don't sell to cinemas or market any kind of content theatrically. So the challenge we always face is the same challenge I think that any new media platform would face, in that it's television. There will be an advert, you can change the channel. Maybe you don't like what you're watching, maybe you don't agree with it, maybe you just feel like flexing your thumb, you're going to change channel. And ultimately, the challenge has always been, and I would argue has always been, to maintain people's interest in the subject. So not only do you have to, our job, kind of commercially, is to create the noise around the launch or broadcast of said documentary, but ultimately, if the form isn't right and the story isn't there and it's not interesting and someone doesn't care about it, or it's a perspective they completely disagree with, they're going to go and watch something else somewhere else or do something else. Mm-hmm. And I think that's true of anything on YouTube or of anything on kind of any of the EST platforms you can sell to now, or any of the S4 platforms, or any television network. You know, it's the same issue over and over again. It's not, that hasn't, I don't think, changed.
I strongly agree with that. I think it depends on the subject, you know, because it's easy to get tempted or seduced by new technology and then make it a sort of sad extension of what you're working with, just to force your idea onto that platform. So I think it's important that the ideas match the medium that you work with.
I mean, like, if you think about Making of a Murderer, which has been one of the most successful documentary series on an S4 platform ever, and potentially well known, that is basically a story about a man who might or might not have killed someone. Like, I could pitch you that and it would sound really boring, but they managed to, like, spin that out over a number of hours and maintain someone's interest. Like, that is the point. It's the way they've told that story that actually is much more interesting than any kind of a facet of the story, and it's an innovative of itself. You know, it's not actually the man and the murder, it's the way they've told that. And I think that isn't a particularly new thing. You can go back to like 1992 and look at The Thin Blue Line, which is again one of the best documentaries ever made, interestingly, because of the way the story is told. obviously there's a bit more to that as well, but.
Andy, do you want to come in on that?
It's trying to think about the different points, but I think there's a danger. I was going to agree, but I have to disagree now. The danger is if movies are the hair and we have the gravitas, then it's sort of what you don't want to be making is sort of school lessons or mm-hmm. These are the facts and is the correct version of the truth 10 years later. So actually, I think in it, I'm being objective, and I think. I think Thin Blue Line is interesting. People talk about being, it's like recreations, recreations or shouldn't be subjective. I think actually, documentary needs to start thinking about being a bit more subjective, a bit more fun, and actually start to, tell better stories and develop, different formats and play with the format more. And I think doing that, makes it more relevant for this, the current world that we're talking about, that sort of instant world.
And perhaps by doing that, you unpick the idea, because you mentioned that T word earlier, mm-hmm. this concept of truth.
Yeah.
Documentary's always been inexorably linked to this concept that it gives us truth, and yet, of course, it doesn't.
Every decision, it's thousands of decisions made during that process, isn't it? So, whose truth is it? And so I think it is exactly. It's funny how people are sort of scared of subjective, but I think actually people should embrace it more.
I think your point about subjectivity is interesting. Again, if we go back to the internet world, because every action now is a subjective action. Every piece of information I pull in is subjective, which means objectivity mm-hmm. becomes a problem. In fact,
Donald Trump.
But I think to find truth, you had to open things out because there was a lot that was being broadcast that wasn't. It was a version of a truth. You just have to just go to America and think how many, what has been portrayed as truth that is now being exposed as lies or just been manipulated. I think that. Having more voices, having that opening up is a good thing. How it balances will be, telling. Mm. But, I think it's far more exciting being able to access different truths and you can make your own mind up.
Yeah. And again, with the advent of the internet and certainly with internet viewing, we have reversionings of documentaries. I'm particularly thinking of version 22 of Loose Change. This constant updating of the documentary. Do you find that that's something that may be on the horizon for more work?
I don't see why not. It's just I'm not sure you're going to get, from a commercial point of view, I'm not sure whether the cost of doing that is going to necessarily lead to the benefits commercially that you might, the incentive to do it. We had a couple of documentaries... the film Spotlight, that whole case, which were made for Channel 4 a while ago. And we did think about updating those in the light of various kind of news events that occurred and making that more relevant. But ultimately, the cost in doing that is not, at the moment, covered by any revenue you might find afterwards. And ultimately, that's the... point of me as a distributor.
Absolutely, and it is the point of a film industry.
Well, yeah, to make industry money.
And it's one of the things that I talk about a lot with my students. My students, as any perhaps if you're documentary makers, want to make their story, whether it's commercial or not. And that becomes a challenge.
But then I think ultimately, like I was saying about the way you make the film, the form that you use to make it, you could have technically the most boring idea in the world. It's about a man with a grey roof. But if you tell that story in an interesting way and give it a perspective that might be interesting or challenging, suddenly I'm not saying it will be, but it could become more interesting. It could become more commercially viable.
So I'm just going to turn to Tom. Tom, you've got your sort of first big work coming out. So the story of that, how have you honed that and developed it?
Well, interestingly, I mean, that was something from day one we really, really, really tried to think about our audience. And the way we've approached it is it's a bike film, so ultimately that's your big surface one. But we've really tried to think in all areas of life. We want to try and put something in that's there for everyone. So rather than looking at everything very factually, because you could do it so easily, this film is about a disabled bike team, you could go, well, this is a fact, this is a fact. We've tried to really, really... it's connect, and as you said, it's about telling a story. You can give the same film and content to five different people, and you'll have five completely different films at the end of it. I'm probably going a bit off topic here. What was the question? I'll try and get back on.
How did you hone your story?
How do we hone our story? So, I think as a filmmaker, we had a message we wanted to share the world. And our message is, you know, we're massively into our adventure and survival and having a go whatever your dream is. And that's what we wanted to bring as filmmakers. So in everything we did and any content we captured from the very start, we made sure that was a really big part of everything we're doing. And that's the message we're trying to express and share and bring out in all of our interviews and contribute to work.
Ulrike, as someone who's made a lot of documentary work, you again will be used to shaping and creating. Yeah. With this notion of a changing audience, how do you push your view, how do you push your passion within a commercial world?
Yeah. Well, it's tricky. It's a constant fight, that's for sure. But... I was just thinking about that, about how do you keep the audience with it? Or the one that I'm working on at the moment, and it's about a young war reenactor who's turning himself into a musician and front singer of a hard rock band. And so quite a complex story, but about identity and modern male masculinity. And thinking about telling the story is to, you know, keep it active. And luckily, because of the subject that I'm working with, I have a lot of opportunity to have a lot of action scenes. And so that's a way of keeping, I guess, you know, the audience into it and looking at gang culture as well and how war is played out there. You know, and that's a way of, you know, targeting your audience or ensuring that, you know, you have reach a tone that speaks to the people that you want to speak to.
So the concept of story shaped by audience, shaped by maker, shaped by tone, as you said, is challenging.
Yeah, because, you know, if you don't consider it, then it's very selfish, first of all. And then you can assume that your film ends up somewhere on the shelf and doesn't talk to anybody. It is still about communicating to an audience. And I think, so therefore, you need to be aware of your audience and what shapes them and how they respond to, you know, certain ways of telling stories. I think you just can't get away from it.
Marie, you were at Channel 4... the kind of cutting edge of audience, really, with new media and producing short form for those audiences. What did you find kind of drove towards them? What kind of stories worked?
I think there were definitely some... There was definitely a growth in what you'd see, I suppose, if you were just watching, I don't know, the BuzzFeeds and you're watching Facebook and you were just, you know, scrolling. People want emotional... something that emotionally they can connect with. I mean, that's probably the simplest thing you could say about it. But also, I think what we were aware of, say, the difference between doing something for television or just doing something for the internet, is that often if you take the commercial gain out of it for a second, you've got a global audience. You know, so you can actually spend less, you know, instead of like the normal marketing, we're going to try and get as many of any type of person watching the same thing. You can say, well, look, this could be niche. You know, there is an audience here, you know, that will watch this particular thing and in large numbers. Or you might be lucky enough to get a story that has many universal truths that anybody will watch. You know, it's quite hard to... That bit between turning it into marketing or turning it into, you know, making I probably, you know, my in my heart, I feel like you make the thing that you love the best way you possibly can. And then you can, and then you market it. Because I think sometimes things get diluted if you do it the other way around. Mm. You know, if you're trying to start from that audience start point, sometimes things can get a little bit diluted. That's a very personal feeling, but, you know, obviously when you're looking in the commercial world, you start with, okay, well, this many people watched X, we want to kind of get the same sort of numbers again, let's try and make something that touches these points. Mm. I think that's quite hard.
Yeah. What about
No, I completely agree with you. I'm just like, television making or documentary making by numbers is never advisable. If you see a great documentary and go, oh, that rated really well, I'm going to go and make something like that, that's not going to work.
No.
I've worked in channels and that happens remarkably often, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I was at Berlin 3 years ago and I watched a documentary about Himmler's diaries and letters home. And I went to this documentary and it was completely different to what I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be, you know, very kind of, you know, yesterday, straight war history kind of stuff. And it was this beautiful, poetic, visually stunning piece. Not much Nazi memorabilia at all, really. And I remember someone sitting next to me who at the end of it said, that'll never be on television. And yet, 3 years later, this year, in fact, it was shown as part of the Storyville strand. How does that happen?
It's
just
a great film.
It was a great film, yeah.
Yeah. Simple as that.
Yeah, so...
I think that's probably down to like the changing tastes of audiences.
Yeah.
I mean, a Storyville is interesting because it's a strand within a channel, isn't it? So it's looking for a specific type of story, and I don't know, but did you sell him?
So Blackfish was on Storyville, and they titled, or is it Blackfish, the whale that killed, or something like that, so, which I think touches a bit onto the subject of this panel, because if you just have Blackfish, and actually in the cinema we pitched it as Blackfish, that was it, but for TV, it was, you know, that's not enough, yeah, subtlety. You need it's a whale and it kills people.
Yeah.
So some of Himmler's diaries. Maybe I'm not sure what the title would be.
I think they did change the title actually. Yeah.
If you put, well, I shouldn't really say this in a public forum, but if you put like Nazi in the title of something, it generally will sell a lot better than if you don't put Nazi or Hitler or any of the kind of touch phrases or touch words that people are naturally kind of curious about, I guess.
But I think there's a nice thing called Storyville, because they also did Vivian Meyer, for example, which is about the photographer, lost archive of photographs. But that Storyville, you know, halo, in a way, can sort of take more risks, so people will start to watch that to give it a shot and trust the Storyville brand to watch that film. Mm. So I think that's, you know, what you call it, there's a nice, you know, virtuous circle of that.
Mm. It's like you wouldn't expect to see an unreported world type story in an Imagine or an Arena type strand. Like, those are the brands that the strands have put together. So, I mean, when it came to pitching a finished product, for example, I don't think I would be selling, you know, some arts documentary to an unreported world buyer, because they're just going to go, why are you wasting my time with this? Yeah. But ultimately, I don't think, like you said earlier, I don't think that as a filmmaker, thinking, oh, I'm going to make a documentary for Unreported World, or I'm going to make a documentary for a specific strand, if you're making it off your own back and you haven't been commissioned to do so, that's not necessarily kind of, that wouldn't be where I would start, I don't think, as a creative process. Mm. Going, oh, there are six strands, I'll make this for this person, you know, that isn't where I'd start at all.
My sense of most young documentary makers is that they're not really conscious of that industrial model. And that's not where their thinking is. Their thinking tends to be with story and with passion and with the desire to get this thing that's in their head out into the world. What do you feel about that as a driver?
I think
you have something interesting. Yeah, exactly. So for theatrical, that's great. And touch on that audience thing, and maybe not do it by the numbers, but when you're making that, when you're developing that story, though, why is that character interesting to an audience? Mm. you know, why would they essentially pay, you know, pay their, you know, £5, £10 for a ticket to buy it? But I think, you know, developing that story, especially with documentary, almost developing it as you go along, you know, you can get away with that and create, you know, some of the best documentaries that have come that way.
There's a friend of mine who's making some work at the moment. He's been making the same documentary for 12 years, and he makes it in parts. And the intention is that each part kind of gets sold, you know, sometimes just for the material, and it gets used in different ways. And eventually, he will have enough to actually finish this documentary. He's kind of funding it by sales in that way. There are new ways of approaching documentary, or new ways of funding documentary. How's that going to affect both makers and distributors and people who buy these things?
It's already affecting, I think, you know, I mean, the democratization of making is, you know, a camera is, you can get a cheap camera and you can film something that could almost be broadcast quality, or could even be broadcast quality, you know, very easily now. It's just whether or not you can take that and then get it onto television. Because normally, from a commissioning point of view, 9 times out of 10, we're looking, you know, commissioners want to work with someone from the beginning, from the idea stage, to bring it through, because they have a good sense of how to make something, all those years of experience, and also how, which audience, where it will fit and how they can get it to an audience. You know, so, but then you do have the internet. So if you, you know, for me, it's, you know, if you want to just, if you're young and you're just coming up, you just, I'm thinking of my beginning times, I just made stuff. I don't really worry about it too much, because that's where you get some experience, you know, and it's kind of brave and it's kind of, but it's fun as well. And you meet people, you meet a team, and you start to discover how you work best with people.
And Tom, has that been your experience?
Yeah, I mean, that's. I think the last few years have been an incredibly exciting time from a filmmaker's point of view. When I started uni, it was the time where the 5D had just come out, and it was like hot topic, and it was this massive change in being able to shoot what looked like very high-end filmmaking, but at a ridiculously affordable rate. And for us as new filmmakers, as you said, I think you're absolutely right, as a young filmmaker, ultimately, you want to have a go at making your story. We have learned so much on this project, with no disrespect, more than I did in uni, to a degree, because you learn things of life as you go. And the great thing for us with doing it is we wanted to do it completely independently without any help, because we wanted to learn, and you know, you only learn by making mistakes. That's the journey. But rather than just putting together something that wasn't broadcastable, the change in technology now has allowed us to put something together I think would stand up in cinema. So we shot everything in 4K on the FS7 when it got launched last year. We pre-ordered that, so the whole film was shot on that. And we, you know, although it's still thousands of pounds, I think for young filmmakers, the technology that's now available to go and do something completely independently but actually to genuinely have a chance of getting it out somewhere, I think the chances are really good. I mean, I think we're a little bit optimistic in the way we think, and it's still a very, very difficult industry to try and break into independently, as we're discovering at the moment. But I still think that for young filmmakers, we have a really, really incredible access to kit. And if you've got a good story and you're really passionate about what you want to tell, there's a lot of opportunities.
So you say about, you know, breaking in. Our industry used to be, you know, lovely middle class folk, largely with their own private incomes, who could afford to kind of wander around and make films.
Has that changed?
I'm not quite certain it has. Actually.
I don't think it has.
But that's where I was going. Has that changed? How do you live while you're doing this? Have you got a paper round? Is what I'm asking.
No. So. It's been quite difficult for us. I mean, I work freelance as a cameraman and editor by trade, and it's been a very, very hard balance between trying to keep up the day job and do our own independent film. But, you know, okay, 10 years ago, there's no way you could have done what we've done. Not at all. You wouldn't have been able to afford the kit or the crews. You know, we're very lucky our generation has grown up with a different kind of technology and it's evolved with us. And, you know, most people can pick up a camera and have a pretty good comprehension of how to use it. You know, so even when I started uni, shooting on HD was the big thing. Mm-hmm. You know, to go out with like one of the big HDX 900s or something was wow. Whereas now, anyone can go and shoot something to a similar quality. Yeah. So, I mean, What's the point I'm trying to get
to? How do you survive?
How do we survive? I still have to work.
Yeah.
Freelance, still have to work.
But I think ultimately, the internet has allowed filmmakers of any genre, and this doesn't specifically apply to documentaries, if you can tell a story in 5 minutes or 10 minutes, or in the length of a YouTube video, which you made on your iPhone, that someone is interested in watching, or even like a million people might be interested in watching, or even like 2 million people might be interested in watching, or even just clicking on, you know, ultimately, someone will find you. Someone boring like me will find you and say, oh, you should do this, or would you like to do that? And do not for 1 second think that there aren't people who spend a lot of their day, there are lots of people who spend days and days and days looking, not only in London or not only in the UK, but all over the world. Like, if you're an assistant in LA, you're spending a lot of your time watching the internet, watching YouTube to find the hottest, the latest, the greatest, the best, the next thing that is hot. And if you're really, whenever I meet someone who's a director, he's like, oh, I'm a director. It's like, oh, what have you made? Oh, I haven't yet because I haven't been able to get hold of, I can't afford the, and it's like, unless you're doing some kind of really intricate CGI thing, in which case get a new story, like find something you can tell on an iPhone. What are you doing? Like, you're not, you're going to be doing whatever it is you do to earn money for the rest of your life, unless you do kind of get out there and just go and make it. Like, you can't, there's almost less excuse now than there has ever been.
I mean, when I started, I think I was a bit sort of all, oh my God, I love film. You know, so I just kind of, you know, it was like 8mm, 16mm, 35. You know, I was just I just found ways. Sometimes it was just, you know, you enter a competition. Sometimes you just apply for the money. You know, and not be afraid of whether you do or don't get it. You just try.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't have loads of money. You know, I just thought, just going to try. You know, and it's possible, I think.
Because there's one, you know, there's a plug for the Grierson Trust. You know, they have the Doc Lab, you know, about getting into an industry, but that deliberately targets, you know, 18 to 25-year-olds and, you know, and gives them paid placements, you know, with established companies like Minnow Films, and it's a great way, and also all sorts of roles as well, so, you know, behind the scenes roles as well, not just, you know, for the filmmaking role, but that is, you know, deliberately targeted at people who wouldn't normally get those opportunities. So the opposite of what you described.
Well, I'm curious, in an earlier incarnation I used to work in the music industry. Around about the time when CDs came in, I should just explain, CDs used to be at that point the music industry was quite happy because they were about to sell all of you the stuff you'd already got again, so it was a really good time, and then suddenly this internet thing came out of nowhere and the music industry collapsed because no one saw it coming. Now, I spend a lot of time looking at Documentary Filmmakers Group, International Documentary Filmmakers Association, and the stuff that they're pouring out online. I look at strange little films that are, you know, made by kids in Russia, great little documentary made by a 12-year-old in Syria recently, just thrown out online. And I wonder if we're actually now dinosaurs, even you. As a new filmmaker working in a traditional form, I wonder if we're about to fall off the cliff.
It's an interesting one talking about social media, because Vimeo has been one of the biggest tools for us ever as new filmmakers, and you seriously shouldn't underestimate the power of it, because it was the short we did prior to the feature that went absolutely viral online. I mean, it ended up going on Channel 9 in Australia. But I mean, as you said, people are out there watching this stuff, and anyone can go on there, it's free. And that's exactly how we started. There's an incredible level of work on places like Vimeo. And yeah, you're right, maybe long form is starting to change because people do want to go on and just watch a 10-minute short or maybe 5-minute short and get that quick dose of, oh, that's a story, it's interesting, and look at the next one.
I think the short form ultimately, from a commercial point of view, faces the challenge that it isn't actually that commercially lucrative. And whilst the internet has changed things drastically in terms of how people consume content and where they consume it, it hasn't meant that the money has gone, because instead of watching it on a TV channel, whilst you're watching adverts, you're paying $7.99 or $9.99 a month to subscribe to a platform, which is where the change has been very much more keenly felt. I think from a young, up-and-coming producer or filmmaker perspective, the kid who's 12 making a documentary that's 12 minutes in on Syria or half an hour in Syria, it levels the field a bit. You know, you don't have to be a nice middle-class person with a paper round to make film. You can just be a kid in Russia, a man in Botswana. It doesn't matter. As long as you have access to relatively rudimentary equipment, like an iPhone, other models are available, you know, you can make a documentary. That's why, that's almost why the noise for our, from a distribution point of view and from a channel point of view, it is more and more important. You know, that's why if you look on your electronic program guide on the telly, you'll see, you know, titles become much more important. What you can fit in the 39 characters on the television become much more important. Like, you can see they put people but new, so you know that it's not a repeat of whatever it was last week.
But actually, that's a great way to almost try and tie those. So I don't know what the answer is, and this is where the 12-year-olds do have it. But that, what is the EPG of the future? So as you say, there's all this great content, 10 minutes, long form, short form, coming out. Yeah, but how do I find the good stuff that I like? Yeah, you know, and like Netflix has their algorithms, but you know, on the rest of the world, like the Vimeos, how would you find it?
Well, through brands like Channel 4 or BBC One or Arena or Imagine or Storyville, or I'm being very specifically documentary focused on this, but you find a brand that you kind of go, oh yeah, I really like their stuff. It's like, how do you pick a newspaper you're going to read? That's how it's the same thing. People go with the editorialized view, and ultimately, at the end of the day, 99, this is really depressing if you're an upcoming documentary filmmaker, but 99% of the people at the end of the day just want to watch something on the telly. They don't have to think about it too much. Can they watch this? Yes, they can. Brilliant. Thanks very much. Mm. It happens to be at 9 o'clock on Channel 4 and is part of the Unreported World strand, or, you know, whatever. But they're just like, oh, it's there. Great.
Yeah.
Click.
I totally agree. It's sort of, it's that people will always come home from work at a certain time, or have children, and just want to stop at 9 o'clock, you know, and getting your content in front of their faces is
Equally, that, like, the interesting thing is, because of the internet, the delivery is methods have changed. So I can now watch Netflix on my telly, and I can watch Amazon, and I can watch all of the other Vimeo. I can watch all of those things on my television. And you know what? Oh, I saw Andy yesterday, or I was talking to Andy at work, and he said, oh, have you watched this program? And I said no, and so, well, maybe we should watch that. And that's what happens. And it's and then the noise kind of creates itself, so it's about building that momentum.
So the screen revolution, the fact that I can watch a film on my Samsung, has that changed your business? Has all this
immensely? But I don't think necessarily immensely, because there are more people to sell to. I'm not sure necessarily that means there's a lot more money. There's lots of different ways you can sell things. And I think from a distributor producer relationship point of view, you know, you need to think about, as a producer, you need to think about, this distributor might be offering me the most advanced, but do they have the best strategy in place for my documentary, television series, et cetera, et cetera. You know, you see it a lot in drama, like the way that producers line up with distributors, especially, is very much more about, you know, is this going to be, are they going to do the right thing for this show internationally? Are they going to take it to that channel? Are they just going to sell it all to Netflix in a first window run? And will that completely devalue it? I mean, obviously, they're not the reason you make the film or television show, but ultimately, they're things that I consider on a daily basis when buying documentaries to sell. Like, how are we going to sell this? Where are we going to sell it? Will people be calling up and saying, oh, hi, I'm from Belgium, please can I buy that show? Or will no one be calling up, and will it be more a question of we need to put it through this place and that place and that place and do this and create some hype around it?
So do you see it as a useful moment where a documentary maker comes together with distributors and maybe at an early stage to consider some of this?
What do you mean by useful? Useful to who?
Useful to shape the piece.
Useful to who? Oh, the documentary maker.
Or to, well, certainly to the distributor.
I'm now like, oh, is that useful to a distributor? I don't know. I think ultimately, depends how early on you, if you're like, oh, I've got a great idea for a TV show, like, not really. That's not really going to be. But if you're like, oh, I've made this show, I'm making this show, I'm thinking about making this show, and it's about this and this and this and this. You know, is it worth me going to the additional cost of splitting the audio track so it can be sold internationally, or other various deliverable things that you need to sell shows internationally? Is it worth me doing that? I can tell you quite easily whether it would be or not. Like, yeah. But that just because I don't think or do think that it'll work, it doesn't mean either way it will or it won't work. It's more kind of, it's about cost that at that point. I think when it comes to the cost of it, that's when it's interesting.
Can I take cost for a moment and go back to story? How does story match against cost? How do we value story?
That's a tricky one. I mean, one of the things I think, it's tricky. Probably can't answer that. But I was thinking while you were talking about, say, short form and the commercial world, because I think that there's a whole other commercial area beyond television where people are buying and paying for, even that, you know, one of my friends is a director, and she's been making half-hour films about artists for Bloomberg. You know, it's a totally commercial, straight to satellite, you know, and that's what she's doing. And, you know, it's great for her because, I mean, she's travelled around the world. She's probably not earning shed load. You know, it's not the same as a television director's salary, but it's still more than enough. And that is, you know, something that they're making because it's sponsored television. You know, I think, you know, that's quite a big portion of what Channel 4 was also doing in terms of short form.
Yeah.
So brands would come to us and say, I don't know, whether it's British Gas or any, you know, someone else, and they would want to pay for a series of videos that, you know, it's kind of brand association, you know, a nice idea and a story that complements their brand. You know, that's a whole other world of branded content out there that people are making money in. And it's quite, I think, sometimes quite a good entry point. I mean, some of the things difficult issues in that area around the brand wanting to control the story in a way that isn't beneficial for the story because they're so busy trying to, you know, get your thing to fit their brand to make it like an advert. But that's really not what works. You see time and time again what works is a great film that has a sort of small link to the brand that is allowed to grow and develop in the way that is best for the actual story. So that's one other way of thinking about how do you make money? Where is money?
But I think that, very exactly, story and cost, but I think, and you also mentioned that distributor and filmmaker, I think what the distributor of the TV can tell you is the value of the story.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, sorry to do a cliche like brass bands in Yorkshire, but yeah, the value of that to, you know, the Belgium distributor is not going to ring up to buy that movie. So what the distributor can tell you is sort of what the value could be in different territories of your story, you know, how local, how global, all that. And then hopefully if that value is X, you know, then that should guide the cost. You know, then don't go and spend 10X you're going to lose.
Yeah, exactly.
What we're going to do, because I think these people are getting exhausted in the heat, and I've made them talk quite a lot, so I do apologise. We're just going to watch a couple of pieces, and then we're going to open the floor to you guys, and then you can ask some questions once they've had time to take a sip of water. So I think we're going to start with Ulrike's piece.
Right. Which is a development trade-off, so it's not the finish.
Yeah. Ulrike, I think in that film you've just answered my question, because never in a month of Sundays of trawling the internet would I have thought to look for a guy who dresses up as a soldier one day and is a heavy rock guy the following. How did you find him?
Oh, I was really interested in war reenactment and started to go to some events, read about it, and then I found out that some people actually take it a step further and base their impression on an actual person. So trying to find someone like that, went, contacted the Screaming Eagles Living History Group, talked to the captain, and he said, I mentioned this, and he said, you've got to talk to Johnny. He's exactly what you're looking for. So it was fluke, and I've been following for a while now. So,
yeah. And I think the beauty there is you illustrate what documentary is about as well. It's about humans. Mm. It's about our shared experiences.
Yeah.
And okay, sometimes about the quirky ones, but it's definitely about our contact with the world.
Yeah.
Perhaps we can turn to Tom's trailer now. So again, where did that story come from?
That was all by chance, actually. A couple of years ago, we were trying to create a few more shorts on Vimeo, just kind of build a bit of a portfolio and profile together under the name Speechless with my partner Ross at the back there. And I happened to be I was in a freelance job, and I heard at a racetrack, and I heard over Tannoy that there was a disabled rider. And I just thought that was incredible. I thought that's really, really unique. So we got in touch with him. We did a short, 10-minute short, and that's the one that then went viral. We got a Vimeo staff pick overnight with the first night of it. It got picked up by Channel 9 in Australia. And like the bike community worldwide is a massive, massive audience, and it just went absolutely crazy. And it was just like hundreds of thousands of views racking up on Vimeo overnight. At that point, we then thought, well, hang on, if you're doing anything else, this is such an incredible story, and there's so much more depth we never got to cover with the short. If you're doing anything else, we'd love to do it with you. So we spoke to Talon, the lead protagonist, and basically said, look, we've got no experience doing a feature or any kind of documentary more than 10 minutes, but we'd quite like to have a go with you if we may.
So that's a really impressive and inspiring story, actually. I think that any of us who make films would like to follow that route. Look, I'm going to open it up to the floor now. If you can wait till the microphone comes to you, and I think our first question is going to be just there.
So, firstly, I'm a documentary filmmaker. I've been in and out of festival over the past more than a decade or so. The question that I have, it's at the same time, it is, I agree that it is exciting to do certain things that was so much more difficult to do before. But at the same time, there are so many festivals that I've been to and films that are absolutely amazing, made by documentary filmmakers. And after a short period of time, these amazing films that try to challenge the form rather than challenge the technique of documentary filmmaking, they just die away. They disappear, nobody talks about them. They sort of have this sort of, unless somebody picks it up at some point, some curator to curate something that had been meaningful maybe some time ago. I just wanted to know what exactly do the panel thinks about the films that are made, and I have even probably touched them, but you haven't heard anything about them after you've seen them in the festival, and whether there's something that needs to be done on a more sort of bigger scale, where I do not agree with the fact that audiences will not be receptive to. You talk about Storyville. Storyville is great, but it's only one Storyville. There is nobody challenging Storyville to bring it to the fourth of the audiences at the point where they can challenge themselves in wanting to watch something that is more than 10 minutes, 12
so,
minutes.
So the question,
there's anything wrong with that.
The question is, what do we do with this mass of material that seems to have an ever shorter shelf life?
And most importantly, these are the things that are really challenging, in my opinion, the documentary form. These are the films that are artistically and in terms of what exactly they bring to the whole form, I think that they're at the forefront of it, but they're not really given the PR that they deserve.
I can't answer that exactly, but I think that the sad truth is that there are a lot of people making a lot of stuff and only some things can reach an audience. Mm. Is the sad truth of it. You know, and some of it is luck and some of it is design and some of it is who you know and some of it isn't that. But, you know, it's a tough reality. They're possibly, but equally I can also say, are there enough, you know, in terms of brands, I still reveal there's something on television, but are there enough platforms that are designated to reach, you know, to provide, okay, you say Vimeo, but that's very, always feels very industry, you know, but I know it has a wider public reach, but it's sort of, where do you go to find these things?
Well, I think another alternative, it's a, you know, a huge step, but I think it's a step. You have screens such as Dockhouse and Picture House, you know, that haven't existed for that long, that have dedicated screens for documentary only, and these need to be filled. And I think that's opened up, you know, possibilities for a lot of filmmakers. It's still curated, it doesn't mean, you know, anybody can show work, but it's outside of television and film festivals, another way of seeing great documentaries that don't make it on television. Hmm. So,
but yeah, no, exactly. So, I mean, we're a theatrical distributor, so inherently we're limited. Yeah, you know, just do over 12 films a year. So that's, yeah, you know, that's one a month, right? So there's a capacity because clearly there's many more good documentaries made, as you say. Yeah, Bertha Dockhouse is a great example. So they're picking up especially strong, you know, festival docs that are not getting a wide release, but they're giving it that platform. But I do think, you know, we've talked about these trends. The nice thing in the new world, you know, let's say iTunes or Vimeo, is that as a filmmaker, you know, if your film does not get that deal, there are options that you can fall back on and, you know, build that audience yourself, and you know, you get into all this self-distribution world, but at least you have an option.
I mean, I think, just to put my 4 pounds within, I'm going to guess that within the next 5 to 10 years, the same model that Amazon gets, you know, you liked this, here's a bunch more that you might like. I think that model will come into internet search engines, and it'll be a simple case of, if you've looked at one of these documentaries, it will find you 10 more in that ilk.
But my problem with it is that those are the people who are already familiar and are looking for that form. My problem with it is that there's nobody else challenging to expose the audience to different forms of documentary filmmaking so that they can actually judge for themselves. And they would go on Amazon and choose one so that Amazon would give them 10 more. Because as things stand, they would never go towards them. And you know, I think it's a slightly elitist sort of attitude towards saying that, okay, the general public will not want to watch an art documentary. Or not an art documentary, a documentary a little bit more challenging visually and conceptually. Documentary, let's just give them a lot of you know, quick hits so that they forget about it after 10 minutes. I mean, that was a bit extreme.
But no, I think we take your point. But I think everyone here accepts the fact it's an industry, and an industry has to make money to survive. And often it needs to be Woolworths rather than, you know, Gucci.
I mean,
I was just going to say, I think there are people all over the place, like Curiosity Stream, the doc teams at most channels, and generally, like, people at Netflix who buy documentaries. Like, I think they would all take a little objection to the fact that Storyville aren't the only documentary strand showing good and interesting documentaries. You know, festival documentaries that have a very bizarre form or a very unique form or a challenging form can be very hard to broadcast on television, which has a very innate structure, which is, if it's an hour, it has to run for, in the UK, if it's an hour, it has to run for 45 minutes, and you have to have ad breaks, because ultimately, at the end of the day, there is a commercial reality that comes into this. And yes, you may have a wonderfully artistic and truly challenging of the genre film or television show, but if you can't play it on television so that when my dad comes home from work, he can turn on the telly and go, oh, look, that's interesting. It's not, you know, that's not going to be mainstream, and ultimately there's a commercial reality there.
And we've got a question just over here.
Sorry. It's a little bit different. Hi, I'm Holly. I work as a development researcher and also a degree in trust. So I just want to say any young people who want to do, who want to make films, a degree in trust doc lab is amazing. I had two distribution questions. You mentioned earlier you can tell really quickly whether something should be, you should put more money in to like make the audio in line so it can be set.
Oh yeah, splitting audio.
Oh yeah, I was just wondering how quickly you can, how much of an idea you need to hear before you know how global it can go. And also, I guess this is more to Andy, how do you choose which things to distribute? I know Dogwoof has a lot of issues, social issues and political stuff. So how do you know, how can you choose which, what you do?
Should I take the first bit about whether you should spend any money on it or not? Yeah. I mean, generally, you want to see more of the idea, i.e. I would like to normally see something that's made or partially made or has some kind of audiovisual element to it, be that like a sizzle or a promo or whatever, in order to know roughly where I would expect to be able to sell it. Ultimately, though, that's all done on experience, so you kind of go with what the current market in your experience is looking to buy. That's how we would pick.
I'm going to let you finish that one, and then we're going to pick up a question here.
Yeah, no, super quick. So how... We started on social issue big time, but we pick, you know, in some ways that was a period where that was super popular, but, you know, we back strong stories, strong characters. I mean, our slate now is, you know, massively diverse, and we have a lot of stuff, you know, here, like JT Leroy, you know, about artists, Iris. And what is great to see, actually, is that diversity of films being made is... you know, is great. So now we get more variety, not just social issue. But in the end, it is we're essentially picking what we think people will pay to see at a cinema.
Yeah.
It's a judgment call.
Lovely, thank you.
So I would like to ask about this documentary versus information relation. And something that came up earlier today at the archive masterclass was about like films that we know the ending of. So like we talked about Senna and Amy. What kind of challenges do those kind of films provide in a kind of marketing and sales perspective when kind of everybody knows the information about it, everybody knows the outcome, which is that, you know, they die. But then how do you then like market it to the audience when they already know what's going to happen?
I mean, surely from like a filmmaker's point of view alone, I think, Andy, you touched on this earlier, you can know the outcome of the story, but the way that the filmmaker then tells you a completely different depth of that story, it could completely change your perspective of that story. And I don't know about the marketing side so much, but from a filmmaking side, that's what you're doing. And how you package and put that together, I'm sure, is the same principle.
No, exactly. I mean, Netflix would sum it up. So exactly, you know the story, and you talked about, you know, like Making of a Murderer. The trick is that the next day... there's that wow moment of how you tell the story that basically you will then tell your friends about. So you need to uncover something or develop something in that story.
Yeah, or give someone a deeper understanding of a character who may or may not have been famous whilst they were alive. That's why you watch Amy and that's why you watch Senna.
Lovely, I'm going to take another question then.
Is there a space for both? I mean, for information and for the documentary. Let's take the example of Blackfish itself, right? I mean, while the film itself is amazing, and but in the larger space, if you see, there's a lot of people who know about Blackfish who have not seen Blackfish, right? Mm. They would have just seen the trailer. They probably read about it. They were tweeting about it, Facebooking about it, right? All of that is needed to bring these pieces. Yeah. Some people are coming to see, but then there's also this social movement around it for which because they just know enough about the film that they can go and talk. So isn't both kind of helping each other in some ways? Should we choose between the two for every story? And don't they both exist? Like you need to have that little tiny video that's going out, or the soundbite that's going out, or the picture that's going out with it. Like, I mean, this has happened with Blackfish, this has happened with Cove. I mean, any of these kind of
things,
right?
I agree.
I mean, do we have to choose? Do we have to kind of talk like this? And if there is a narrative that's going on in the media, in the news media, that you can connect to and bring the story back into light or whatever, like, is there something that we need to kind of think more about?
Do we need to choose between the two? Is the question, I think.
Yeah. Do you need to? No. I mean, the trick is to get them feeding each other. Yeah, it's a synergy. And actually, I'm trying to think. You know, Blackfish clearly can talk about that. There's, you know, actually every quarter, SeaWorld does their results, and usually they're down, so almost inherently. And it's a public company, so it's got no choice but on a targeted date, everybody knows they're going to say something, and usually they add, but we're different, and then thousands of people or millions of people hammer it. And then the more people, as you say, it's not a one-for-one relationship, but basically lots of more people then go and watch the film. So you do get that thing. But I think for the motorbike community, I mean, it'd be interesting your take almost of, you've got a big community of motorcycle fans, and you've got the film. So again, I think you need that immediate information of people chattering about it. But
I'm going to bring Marie in on this one. I remember what you were doing a couple of years ago.
Yeah, so there was a point when, I don't know, in Channel 4, information alongside the programme was, like, really key, you know, and I don't know, it wasn't even that long ago, but it feels like it's probably a year since we stopped doing it a lot. But, you know, a lot of programmes were accompanied by the information that you could find out more, that you, because they were either newsworthy or it was a social story. I don't know, even the space season last year, that came with loads of extra factual information. It was really popular online. You know, we used to call it sort of multi-platform. You know, but it kind of happens more organically now, I think. But I do think that if you are, I mean, I feel that it's helpful if I watch something and I can immediately find actually, you know, information that has been checked, that isn't biased, that, you know, I can go to and I can find out more and I can get more information, because you do it. I mean, I do it anyway. I just, you know, you just pick up, you know, you just go on Google, isn't it? You just look it up. You know, but, you know, some, you never know what you're going to find. You know, so I think actually maybe that is a small responsibility if you're going to be making something that's science-based or, you know, historical, that you maybe you accompany with some facts or you tweet some facts and information out at the same time.
Because what actually on the Blackfish, a good example, I forgot about the second screen, but so every time Blackfish screens on the BBC, and it screens again recently, I mean, Twitter erupts. And then, curiously, yeah, of course, then more people start watching it on the BBC, because they're not watching the BBC, they're on Twitter watching something else, and suddenly it's like, oh, and they switch, and that's the reverse then, they're switching over to watch it, but because of the information.
So, I mean, I guess my point is, that means then we can build audience, or we can drive content using this information in a way that while we're looking at these are butting heads, but they're kind of
definitely.
The very nature of documentary is informative. That's the difference between a documentary and a drama. You know, they're still all telling stories, but that's the luxury that documentaries are afforded, the ability to inform people.
And that was why, so you thought, you know, originally we did social issue movies, and that was a key reason why, was, you know, to find that audience and motivate them, you know, activists and issue people. You know, tweeting, they want to tweet about something, about their issue. So if you do a film about, you know, overfishing and something.
I'm going to interrupt because we've got time for one more question, if that's all right.
Thank you. My question is kind of two parts, but I'll try and package it into one. The first one, we were talking about the new generation of people that are consuming content these days on Facebook, et cetera, and having a close up for a pre-roll, so you just grab them straight away. Hit him with the information. If that's true, and there's a whole wave of people coming up that really just need instant gratification, and if stories are really about tension and release, creating tension, building, and then releasing, and over through that cycle, and we look at two sort of extreme documentaries, one, Jiro Dreams of Sushi, and on the other one, The Imposter. You know, Jiro Dreams of Sushi is a great film, I love it, but it's a kind of, in my opinion, it's a slow and sort of meditative film, and it shows this lovely guy who's got this sushi restaurant he's had for ages and stuff. And The Imposter is very, very dramatic. It's like, you know, when I watched it, I was constantly asking myself, is this like a Hollywood blockbuster that just happened to have a thread of truth attached to it, or is it a documentary that, you know, they were very clever to build it in a way that was just going to keep you on the edge of your seat? And same thing with Making a Murder and You know, and when you market a film now, or when you create a documentary film, if you wanted to have a shelf life, should you be thinking, you know, should I find a subject that has this tension and release, keep people right on the edge of their seat, like Cartel Land, you know, for example, huge film, did really well. You know, 10 years from now, are we going to make films like Jiro Dreams of Sushi, or are we going to have to be in the middle of a war zone?
Are we going to have to adapt the form for this rapid market, or are we going to have to adapt the marketing of other films to adapt for the market?
What about the filmmakers? What type of films are you going to make? Because in some ways, that it's the future. So to me, that's it's the filmmakers starting to make those films now in that world is going to appear. So I think that will drive it.
Yeah, I mean, we're the reactive in this instance to what the A is available in the market and B, people want to see. Like, we are the uncomfortable bit in between. And obviously our marketing will change to fit the kind of film or content of any description that you're looking at. I don't know, ironically, I actually think that the sushi documentary is potentially more timeless. But that's because it's about sushi. Does that make sense?
It makes sense to me.
Yeah, rather than like a specific political issue that is relevant right now.
I think it takes us back to that argument of, you know, you make a film because you're passionate about the subject, and you adapt the form to the subject. So I think that's what we talked about all along. You know, it's your style and what you feel is authentic, or your way of telling a film. I'm not going to change my style all of a sudden. No, I consider it, but again, you know.
Then, like, sometimes too, I think, because I just finished making a film about Rio de Janeiro and the favelas, I think when I start telling it, you know, describing it, people are instantly thinking Cartel Land. They're like, oh, the favelas, it's going to be a shootout, and several people are killed and stuff.
Is
there? There is violence in the background of my film. It's there. And when I make a trailer, do I put some of that violence right up front? And if I do, how do I pay that off? The film isn't...
Right, yeah. I think that's very important, because the audience can potentially feel fooled. Yeah.
I think it comes back to a point that you were making earlier about the integrity and honesty of the filmmaker. And of course, it's a big problem. But I'll just say a quick thing. I'm getting to an age where I've lived enough now, and things are coming back round. So when DOA came out, the punk documentary, everyone said, these beautiful languid films, they're dead. This is how we're going to do documentary. Well, that lasted about a year. And I suspect that, you know, there does tend to be trends in documentary, and I think it's always going to be about picking the right moment. We do have just time for a very, very quick last one, and there was a man with a hand, which is always handy.
Don't you think that documentary's main power is when I'm involved in a programme, I always say we're at war with Wikipedia, stop people deciding to go online and find out facts about the subject and then going on to whatever. Don't you think that it's actually character and testimony that there's a secret weapon of documentary? Because actually it's not always about what the documentary maker wants a story to be, it's actually about what the characters in your documentary is going to be. And it's also, it's not just all action. So I've worked in a number of documentaries recently which are all about emotion. So if you've got something with an emotional hook and you want people to like the character and you get that in, you can do a flashy pre-title, but actually what you do is let the audience learn to love that character.
Ulrike.
I completely agree with you. I'm not quite sure how to answer that. I don't quite know what the what the question is.
It's almost, don't you think, actually, documentary has to remember its roots. It's almost we sometimes worry about new form and what we're competing against. And actually, let's sit back and say, well, we've got viewers for an hour. Yeah. We can actually, if it's on television, it lends some gravitas. So when I worked on the Dunblane documentary, it was on BBC Two recently, I can say to contributors, you're going to talk about the worst moment in your life, but it's going to be on BBC Two. it's going to have a bit of gravitas there. It's an emotional, it's not going to be 10 minutes on, online. So it's a bit like sometimes documentary has to sit back and say, let's get back to bare bones.
So let's get us back to the bare bones. Is that the thing we should do?
Well, I think, you know, documentary is all about access. You know, if you haven't found an interesting, compelling character, you don't have a great film. You know, you're unlikely to have a great film.
Yeah. Getting on to your point, though, because this is a real bone of contention with us, because my background's news, and I don't like the way journalists approach a lot of stuff. Going in there, as you said, and going, oh, you have got to tell us your deepest, darkest fears, I can't stand that style of filmmaking, because you're not getting, to me, you're not getting an authentic character. And I think some of the best documentaries you watch are the ones where it's very, you're leading them very, very subtly. The ones that are going, right, you've got to get this across.
No, completely. Yeah. I make a lot of documentaries that get a lot of emotional content. It's usually, I don't say, this is going to be your darkest moment, but it's actually a case of, what we are going to ask of you is going to be painful, no matter what, and we'll do it incredibly sensitively, and do a lot of care, and we've got a lot of care and backup with that. It's just a case of, but if you're going to put yourself through this, it's going to be done in a place that you are comfortable with. You as a contributor are aware of the BBC. You as a contributor know what television is and you know what a big 9 o'clock.
So I think we're coming back to that notion again of integrity.
That's it. As it lends itself, it's got a standard. I never ever say we're going to talk.
Oh, no, of course.
It's a case of if you're going to sacrifice time and emotional effort into something and give the story for the first time, as all those contributors did, then it's got to be somewhere that it will be treated.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely.
I think you should never exploit anyone. Any filmmaker that's doing that and not telling them the truth about what they're doing means it shouldn't be making it, really. But, you know, I would hope so anyway. I would hope that most people know that if they've maybe been to college and done journalism or understand.
We've got time for one comment.
I was going. No, it sums it up, I think, which is like misinformation. And I think I love journalists, but you know, papers are suffering. So I think, who's telling the stories, the integrity, and it used to be the journalists, but they're, look at WikiLeaks and everything, that they're not doing, they're not doing that for whatever reason. And there's all this information and all this instant information. So I think the job of the documentary filmmakers is exactly to, tell those stories, find those characters, get that access. So I think that's a great, there's a great need for good documentaries.
And that's a great note for us to end on. Will you join me in thanking the panellists?